G'day, welcome to this time and this place. As we gather, hear from the words of the psalmist. Psalm 119, verse 7. I will praise you with an upright heart. I will learn of your righteous ordinances. The praise of God comes from the understanding of who God is and what God values. Let's pray. Loving Father God, we thank you that you are present with us in this place, that your promise is true, that where two or three gather, even as we are bound together through this medium, you are part of what is going on. You are speaking to our hearts. So Lord God, as we come in worship, we pray that you would lift from us any burdens, any fears, any sin, any anxieties or worries. That you would lift from us any pride, any self-righteousness, any sense that we have that we deserve you and your love. Help us to sit in the beauty of grace. Help us to sit in the knowledge that you first love us. Help us respond in love and holiness and in humility. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's sing some praise to God.
Gathers those who wandered far, heals the hurt and broken spirits, tending every wound and scar. Sing to God with joy and gladness, hymns and songs of gratitude. With the voice of praise discover that to worship God is good. Such is God's great power and wisdom, none can calculate or tell. Keen is God to ground the wicked and with humble folk to dwell. Sing to God with joy and gladness, hymns and songs of gratitude. With the voice of praise discover that to worship God is good.
God with clouds a sky has curtained, thus ensuring rain shall fall. Earth responding grows to order, food for creatures great and small.
Sing to God with joy and gladness, hymns and songs of gratitude. With the voices of praise discover that to worship God is good.
The story from the Lost Sheep series. Tina, the tree.
Tina, the tree. Australia is a dry, hot place. But carving its way through the country is a life-giving river. And there beside the river, branches stretched wide and her roots growing deep into the water, is Tina, the tree. "Good morning, Tina," said Gwen the galah. "Am I glad to find you. I'm expecting a baby, and that hollow branch is the perfect place for my egg."
"A baby," cried Tina. "You're going to have a baby?"
"It's Tina the tree to your service." You don't want to lay your nest eggs in a hollow branch. What you need is a nest. There. There you go, Gwen. Now start laying. Back to the river ran Tina. Hi, Tina, said Spider Steve. Am I glad to see you? These flies are driving me bonkers. Do you mind if I spin a web to catch the flies? Catch the flies? It's Tina the tree at your service. I'll help you catch those pesky flies. Catching flies is harder than it looks, said Tina, as she slowly walked back to the river. Where have you been? Said Karen the koala. It's way past my lunchtime, and my tummy's rumbling. I need to munch some gum leaves. A rumbling tummy? Climb aboard. It's Tina at the tree at your service. You don't want gum leaves. What you need is fruit. Let's visit the Kwandong tree. Tina, said the Kwandong tree, koalas can't eat Kwandongs. Koalas eat gum leaves. So go back to the river. Lily the lizard came down to the river to drink. She always drank beside Tina so that she could quickly climb to safety if dingoes came. Sun blazed, Lily drank, and Kaz the kangaroo bounded across the desert. Oh no, cried Tina. The kangaroo's going to get sunburnt. She needs shade. It's Tina, Puff Puff. The tree, Puff Puff Puff. At your service, Puff Puff. Tina staggered to a rock and sat down. Tina, said Kaz, if you'd like to help us, just stay by the river. Tina, the tree, we're at your service. Back to the river, they carried Tina. From that day, Tina stayed on the bank of the life-giving river, branches stretched wide, and her roots growing deep into the waters. When the galah raised her chick, Spider Steve scared those pesky flies, Karen the koala munched on the gum leaves, Lily the lizard stayed safe on the branches while Dingo and Kaz the kangaroo kept cool in the shade. Tina the tree was at their surface.
Do you know people like Tina? Do you know the times where you have yourself been like Tina? Something about this story, this tree that wants to help, but in the enthusiasm to help, loses sight of who they are and what they have to offer. The story is in part a story about integrity. A story about being true to who you are. Who we are. A story about embodying who God created us to be. To walk the path that God sets for us. To not get lost and distracted by wanting to be everything that everybody else is. There is almost a sense where one of the challenges of life is to be other than we are. And I'm all for learning, training, allowing God to unveil new gifts, new skills, new calling in our lives. Heck, my first stint at university was at Ag Science. Then I went back and did nursing, and then I went back and did theology. God moving me into new spaces. But it needs to be spaces of authenticity. We need to be who God created us to be, who Christ died that we might be, whom the Spirit is calling and empowering us to be. And if that means stopping by the river and standing still, then maybe that's who we are. Let's pray. Loving Father God, we thank you for storytellers, for people who communicate to us through the images and words of imagination. We thank you for the many ways in which we learn and encounter you. For you are generous, you are good, you are love. So we pray for our world. We pray this week for Turkey and Syria and for people around the world whose hearts are aching. We continue to pray for Ukraine and for the nations around. We pray for the people of Russia that have been led into this terrible war by men seeking power and domination. Lord, we pray for an outbreak of peace, for a generous heart, for a willingness to sacrifice that others might live. Lord, we think of those places in Africa, in Asia, South and Central America, the Middle East, where war has been part and parcel of life for generations, where gang violence and criminal cartels seek to impose their way. Lord, we pray for peace. In our own communities and to the ends of the earth, we pray for healing. Healing of bodies, healing of minds, healing of souls, healing of relationships, and healing of creation. Lord, the task is beyond us to complete on our own. We need you near. So we offer ourselves, our words, our energy, our gifts, our skills, and our time to the service of your mission, to the service of your kingdom, to the service of the way of Christ. We ask, Lord God, that you receive us and all we have. And in your wisdom and your strength, may we all step out and be who we are created to be, that others might be blessed. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Let's sing some more.
Took a walk outside of my walking, stepped inside another's shoes, walked the dusty borders between us, paths I'd never chosen to choose. How then shall I live? How then shall I live? How then shall I live? Oh God, how then shall I live? Heard a sound outside of my listening. Felt the living hum of the ground. Waited on the voice of the spirit, singing with its new old sound. How then shall I live? How then shall I live? How then shall I live, oh God? How then shall I live? Saw the world outside of my looking, gazed upon the eyes of its soul. Held the hopes and fears of tomorrow, found the pieces making the whole. How then shall I live? How then shall I live? How then shall I live, oh God? How then shall I live? Took a step outside of my walking, found within a beat that we share. Walked with you the length of a lifetime, and made of life a living prayer. How then shall I live? 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 How then shall I live?
As we continue to think about commitment, some more of the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, 21 to 37.
You have heard that it was said to the people long ago, "You shall not murder, and anyone who murders will be subject to judgment." But I tell you that anyone who is angry with a brother or sister will be subject to judgment. Again, anyone who says to a brother or sister, "Raca," is answerable to the court, and anyone who says, "You fool," will be in danger of the fire of hell. Therefore, if you are offering your gift at the altar and there remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar. First, go and be reconciled to them, then come and offer your gift. Settle matters quickly with your adversary who is taking you to court. Do it while you're still together on the way, or your adversary may hand you over to the judge, and the judge may hand you over to the officer, and you may be thrown into prison. Truly I tell you, you will not get out until you have paid the last penny. You have heard that it was said, "You shall not commit adultery." But I tell you, that anyone who looks at a woman lustfully has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to stumble, gouge it out and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one part of your body than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to stumble, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one part of your body than for your whole body to go into hell. It has been said, anyone who divorces his wife must give her a certificate of divorce. But I tell you that anyone who divorces his wife except for sexual immorality makes her the victim of adultery, and anyone who marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Again, you have heard that it was said to the people long ago, "Do not break your oath, but fulfill to the Lord the oaths you have made." But I tell you, do not swear an oath at all, either by heaven, for it is God's throne, or by the earth, for it is his footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great King. And do not swear by your head, for you cannot make even one hair white or black. All you need to say is simply, "Yes," or "No." Anything beyond this comes from the evil one.
You have heard that it was said to the people long ago, "You shall not murder, and anyone who murders will be subject to judgment." But I tell you that anyone who is angry with a brother or a sister will be subject to judgment. Again, anyone who says to a brother or a sister, Raca, is answerable to the court. And anyone who says, you fool, will be in danger of the fire of hell. You know the law, says Jesus. We've had it for a very long time. There is a sort of backhanded comment in this. You know it, but you don't always live it. But then he says, I'm going to take you further. Because you've got this framework. You've got this legal framework, this enforceable framework. If you do the crime, you do the time. But he says, you know what? That's just the outward things. And God is about the inward things, the hidden things. Because for God, they are not hidden. What Jesus is doing is saying, you know what? One of the emotions that rises when someone is murdered is anger. Anger can drive us to terrible things. Remembering, of course, that Jesus got angry, that God gets angry. So there is a space to get upset, frustrated, annoyed, disappointed, even angry at what is going on in our world. We might be angry at the way the weak, the children, the widows are being treated. But the question is, what do we do with that? Do we deal with that in a way that is God-honoring? Jesus says, this is about the heart. This is about the heart. Before you take the word Raca and start throwing it around, perhaps a lesson in the ancient Greek translation of the ancient Aramaic. Raca. It's a word for empty or foolish, worthless, empty-headed, the empty one. All of those phrases are a dismissal of that individual, a denying their value as a child of God. And if we deny the value of another, then we deny what God has done. We discard it, we trash it, we denounce it. Jesus says that is a really unhealthy place to be. And again in this passage, Jesus says, here is the law, but I tell you, it's not about being good in the eyes of the world and keeping the law, though that is good. Jesus says, I've come that you might not just have to constrain yourselves to stay in the law, but that you might in me engage your heart, get your heart right, so that the law is fulfilled without you even thinking about it. For when our heart is aligned with the heart of God, the things of the law become second nature. When we see in the other the image of Christ, we will no longer use derogatory language towards them because they bear the image of the Lord Jesus Christ. And when they hurt us and damage community, if we have the heart of Christ, our first reaction is not anger and degradation, but deep sadness at the brokenness that exists in that person's life that gives release to the negative in their life. What Jesus is saying here is when we allow ourselves, to be transformed, to be who God created us to be, through an understanding of God and a commitment to the way of Jesus and a surrender to the work of the Holy Spirit and a personal discipline to hold those things high, to walk that path, to deny ourselves and take up our cross. When that is our way, in humble gratitude, we will discover that the law becomes second nature, that the law is written on our hearts. Not so that we have to reference it and go, oh, am I inside or outside of the law? But we will be within its boundaries because we will be living the way of Jesus. And so Jesus says, let your yes be yes and your no be no. And I know, friends, that for many of us, there are deep things that could be brought out of this, and references to marriage and divorce and all of that sort of stuff, which are real world issues and real world struggles. I just today don't have the time to pull that apart, except to say this. Jesus is not, in the first place, talking about applying the law. Jesus is in the first place talking about the condition of our heart, the condition of our mind, our soul, the thoughts, the attitudes that flow through us. Jesus is saying, no pretending, no grandstanding, no outward appearance that covers up an inward turmoil. But let's have an integrity of person and be committed to that. Have a fair dinkum attitude towards being a child of God. And in a world of grand speeches and fancy titles, let our yes be yes, our no be no. Let our speech reflect our actions, and may both be deeply rooted in the reality of our soul, to the glory of God and the blessing of creation. Let's pray. Loving Father God, we thank you for your love, for your deep commitment to us. We commit ourselves afresh this day to walking in your way and your ways, to being transformed inwardly, that the world might see outwardly the person of Christ. Grow in us this day your grace, your love, and your commitment to service. May we give up the pretenses and the pretendings that mark our lives. And may we be who you created us to be. To your glory and in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Let's sing.
We will die with you on the crossroads. We will live in your dangerous places. We will love.
So friends, go. Go into a world of need. Go into a world of blessing. Go into God's creation. And live. Live what we declare we believe to the glory of God. In Jesus' name, amen.